history. Don't know much biology. Don't know much about a science book. Don't know much about the French I took. But I do know that I love you. And I know that if you love me too, what a wonderful world this would be.
Hello, this is History Spaces, and I'm Jerry Anderson, your host. And say hello to Jeff Messerman, who's always here with me. Hi, Jeff.
Good morning. Halloween edition here. It won't be Halloween when you're listening to it, but it's Halloween when we record it. And we got quite the trick this morning, didn't we?
Yes, I'm looking out our expansive window into the bleak winter landscape.
Christmas? Halloween? I don't know what that, whatever this is.
We're recording on Halloween. Go back on SoundCloud. We have a, an episode about witches.
Oh, yeah.
That's out there. So if anyone wants to listen to that.
We burned a few last year, didn't we?
Yes, we did. So. I think we're about a year and a half into this.
My gosh.
No, more than that.
Oh, more than that. No.
Eight or 9 months.
Wow, coming up on a two-year anniversary this thing.
In February.
That is remarkable.
Yeah.
Very nice.
We'll have to celebrate.
Absolutely. Well, hopefully today, I don't know if you intend to scare the knickers off of us, being Halloween.
No, not Halloween related.
All right.
At all, but anyway, you know, cultural literacy is a really important thing. You know, for example, with the Bible, if you believe it's literally or figuratively, whatever, still to have knowledge of the Old and New Testament really enhances your knowledge and ability to understand our culture and things that are mentioned.
It's a good story, too.
Yes, just a good story.
It's good writing, you know.
Yeah. So, and that leads me into foreign languages, you know, the languages that are very influential on our English today, modern English. We are kind of a mongrel language as well. I mean, we have influences from Spanish, which I think is the biggest one, I'm sure, French, Latin, German, but also the one I'm going to deal with today are the Greeks. Greek language, although it seems kind of remote, however, it's everywhere. And, you know, the Greek myths and the stories are part of cultural literacy, too. I remember I always used to read them to my daughter while she was growing up, so that I knew later on when she would come upon them, she would be familiar with them and not be intimidated by all the odd names and whatever else. So,
absolutely.
Yeah. So anyway, I just wanted to kind of run through this, Jeff. The Greek language and Greek references are everywhere. We just don't realize that they're there. Okay. For example, the term or the phrase "spill the beans."
Sure.
That's, you know, in other words, something that should be kept secret is revealed, etc. That is from the ancient Greeks, because when they voted for clubs and organizations, or even when they voted in their early democracy, you would get a black bean and a white bean given to you, and then you would vote one way or another, yes or no, or this candidate or that candidate, depending on the color of bean. Let's say yes, no. The white one was yes, the black one was no.
Considering the state of our elections and how much they are up for grabs and being hacked and all that, maybe we should return to the beans.
Well, you may have to do that if it all comes crashing down.
Oh, which bean counters, I think, ultimately.
Well, anyway, the ancient Greeks, if you know someone was impatient and wanted to know how the election was going, they could accidentally knock the piece of pottery that was collecting all the beans off the table. It would smash on the ground, and then it would reveal if the black or the white beans, for example, were in the majority, and you'd have an idea of how the election was going. And that was called spilling the beans, and we still use that today, although it's completely lost any relevance. And we don't have no idea where that came from, but that's where that comes from.
Russian hackers were knocking over the bean urn back in 2016.
Yeah. So. Well, anyway, here's another one. For pain, one of the biggest pain medicine is morphine. No, they give it to you or some form of that in pills, or they're just, that's the opioid epidemic that we're going through. But the name for that comes from the Greeks. Morpheus was the Greek god of sleep.
Right.
So there you go. And then we did a show on this next one. You know, when you watch a detective show and they have something that indicates a solution or helps you solve a mystery or a crime, it's called a clue. But a clue was ancient Greek, and it was spelled C-L-E-W, and it referred to the ball of thread that Ariadne gave Theseus when he went into the labyrinth to slay the Minotaur. And anyway.
We don't have nearly enough Minotaurs in our life these days either. You know?
Well, I see a lot of bull out there. I mean, hey.
That's true.
Not dismiss this, too. But anyway. And then how about this? For the Olympics that started in the 8th century B.C., the training and competing for early Olympic events was done in the nude. And the Greek word for that is gymnos. And that gives us our word gymnasium.
Right.
Yeah. So although you don't think of our students running around in the nude at all in the building, but so to speak, that's where it comes from. And in ancient Greece as well, only the wealthy got an education. And it was people who didn't have to work for a living or go out in the fields or for whatever the reason. They had to have a lot of leisure time. And the word leisure in Greek is skola, S-K-O-L-A. And that word is translated into our more modern form, school. Although kids probably don't think that school is very leisurely at all.
Not designed as such. Well,
no.
I certainly did, but that...
Yeah. Well, it depends on how seriously you take this, Jeff.
That's right.
You know, and... Now, how about this one? In 776, at the first BC, at the first Olympiad, they only had one event, and that was a foot race. One event for the whole Olympics. And it was a foot race that went approximately 630 feet, or in our measurement, 210 yards, a sprint. So this unit of distance in ancient Greece was called I hope I'm pronouncing this correctly, S-T-A-D-E, a stadi, stadi, from which we get our word stadium,
absolutely,
a place where athletic events are held. So, and by the way, on the other, let's flip this over. The word gyros, as in the name of the sandwich, does not come from Greece. The sandwich was invented in New York City and was called a gyro, which is Greek for turning, but only because the meat is cooked on a turning rotisserie. So the word is Greek, but it was invented in New York City. Kind of like pizza, you know?
I was not in the mood for one of those until now. Thank you, Jerry.
Well,
I appreciate that.
Still early in the day.
Huge fan of those things.
Well, yeah.
Hard to get one around here, too.
Also, chop suey, Chinese dish.
Right.
Invented in the U.S.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, oh, well. Those are just a few examples of things that are around us, common everyday words and whatever ideas, phrases. But now, Jeff, I have a story to tell. Okay.
That's why you're here.
Yeah, that's where we're going with this. Now, the gods of ancient Greece lived on Mount Olympus, and we all kind of know that. And unlike the Judeo-Christian conception of godly behavior, they often came down from their lofty home on Mount Olympus to mix with humans and get involved in their worldly events. These gods exhibited, Jeff, an array of human appetites and desires that we would find very recognizable. For example, Zeus, the king of the gods, although married to Hera, his queen, and she was the supreme goddess of Olympus, Zeus often fell prey to lust for a mortal woman, succumbed to the temptation, and came down from Olympus to have an affair with the object of his desire. I guess he just couldn't help himself. This is the story of one such occurrence, and its tragic aftermath.
Yeah.
Okay. The offspring of one of Zeus's affairs was a son who was honored by both his father and all the other gods of Olympus, far beyond any honors given to any of his other human children. This son was showered with riches and eventually given a kingdom of his own to rule. Some say it's Lydia, or some say Phrygia, or they're quite close, which was an ancient kingdom in what is now today modern Turkey, which is really in the news quite a bit lately. So
absolutely.
With the Kurds and all that. So, but anyway, the most sacred and impressive privilege that this young man was extended was that of eating at the dining table as a guest of all the gods on Mount Olympus. Now, no other human, Jeff, had ever been extended that privilege. And what's more, they allowed him to partake of the ambrosia and nectar, which are called the food of the gods, which, except for him alone, as I said, no other human had ever been allowed to partake of, because these foods were what gave the gods of Olympus their immortality. Now, this young man, who is now a king, he was very much honored, to say the least. Now, just a little aside, how did these invitations get communicated to this young king? You know, what was their means of communication?
Presumably not email or fax.
Now, there's no post office, internet, or phone or anything, you know, no iPhone. So, Hermes, or we know him pretty much as Mercury. Hermes is the Greek term. Mercury is the Roman term. This god figure with his winged sandals and helmet, he was the messenger of the gods and the conductor of the dead to Hades.
No. Absolutely. And FTD florists were very keen on him and used him as their mascot.
That's right. He's right there. And maybe I wonder how many people realize that.
Absolutely.
Now that you mention it.
Is there still an FTD florist? Is that a 70s reference? I think most of the kids tuning in right now are wondering what the heck I'm talking about.
Oh, gee. Yeah, we're... Well, our world is exiting very rapidly, isn't it?
I noticed that myself.
I hardly even recognize what's going on around me. Something, you know, they have that, the birthday, every day in the newspaper, you know, today is the birthday of all these famous people. And I, as the years have gone on, I recognize fewer and fewer of the people, because these are like movie stars, singers, other pop figures.
Sure.
That my daughter, oh yeah, I know, who is this, Emma? You know, oh yeah, that's so and so. I have no idea.
You know, our parents had to deal with this very same thing, and now it's our turn. our number's up.
It's payback.
Yeah, absolutely.
How does it feel, Joe?
Well, yeah, no, it's all right. Because, you know, we can talk about Red Skelton. or red buttons, for that matter.
Oh,
and we, yeah, you know, so we have our own secret code, our own language.
Milton Berle, Martha Ray, Benny Goodman, just all these people.
Those people, know. And the youngsters are not welcome to our
I
little
have
party
no
here.
Idea. No idea.
It is our duty here on this show to teach them, right? It's,
when people really had talent and all this. So.
Of course, here we are talking about Hermes, and their time definitely has elapsed a bit. So.
Oh, yeah. Well, let's get back to Hermes, the Absolutely. Messenger of the gods with his winged sandals and winged helmet and all that. He's the one that conducted the dead to Hades, carried messages from the gods to humans. He was also a dream god. And the Greeks, before they would go to bed at night, they would offer him their last food or drink before going to sleep. And, you know, people would visit Morpheus then, remember, the god of sleep? So I guess Hermes and Morpheus got along pretty well.
So you didn't scrape your plate. Didn't scrape your plate in the garbage when you're done. You left it on the counter for Hermes. Is kind of what's going on here.
Well, okay. Before you would finish it off, you'd offer it up to him, and then you'd consume it. So
you get flies in the kitchen, but that's fine.
Like kind of like saying grace before a meal,
right?
Yeah. Now Hermes would appear at this young king's palace in Lydia at the direction of the gods or of Zeus, and would extend an invitation to him. And of course, could this young man say no? I don't think so.
I would highly advise against it.
The God of the burning bush speaks. Right. No,
you don't put them
yes.
on hold.
No.
You don't send them to your voicemail.
I'm sorry. I got to check my phone first. Right.
No.
I don't think so. But Hermes would then carry this young man up to Olympus to dine and socialize with the gods. And then Zeus would just dote on his son. Okay. But, Jeff, as if that's not all. The gods also accepted invitations from this young man, Zeus's son, for them to come attend banquets with him in his palace on Earth in Lydia. Now, needless to say, this young king began to feel a degree of conceit and superiority with these ongoing honors that have been extended to him. But this, his pride, wouldn't we call that hubris? I think
I believe
we'll
so.
Come back to this at a later time. Hubris, your fatal flaw. But this conceit was really not his most egregious act. This was just the beginning. He outdid himself by demonstrating his arrogance toward the gods in the following way. He took that next step. He was going to do something about his conceit, and he became arrogant. Okay. He invited the gods of Olympus to a banquet in his palace called Hermes.
Sound effects this week, Jerry. Yeah, I like that.
That's me. You know? Hermes comes banging on the palace door, and the young man says, "Tell them I invite them to a banquet." And so Hermes goes up, the gods accept the invitation, and the date is set. Now, after inviting the gods to this banquet in his palace, he planned to make fools of them and to demonstrate to all mankind that they were not the all-knowing, powerful beings that they pretended to be.
As Iron Man said to Loki, not a good idea.
It's not nice to fool Mother Nature, whatever. So, yeah, he was going to take the next few steps, see how far he could get with this. And, though, he had a plan. He had thought this all out. Quite arrogant. And it was a shocking and atrocious plan to destroy the reputation of the gods forever. That would be it. In his scorn for the gods and his unbounded self-confidence, he did not think that his plans could go awry. I've got this, he thought. Okay. Now, in the tradition of Greek and Shakespearean tragedy, this proved to be his, as we mentioned earlier, his tragic flaw or his hubris that brought about his downfall. Or, Jeff, would it? Let's see as we go through it. His foolishness persisted, and he proceeded with his plan. I guess he had no doubts. Now, on the day of the banquet, he and his only son, Pelops, I hope I'm not massacring, it's P-E-L-O-P-S. I don't want to say Pelops, because those E's usually are short E's and when you translate it sure. into English. Yeah. So I'll say Pelops. His only son, this king's only son, Pelops, went walking in a garden with his father and the son, Pelops, went walking in a garden, and when his son's back was turned, he grabbed out from underneath his clothing a knife and stabbed his son in the back.
Wow.
And killed him. Then he ordered his servants to come out into the garden, take his body, take it to the kitchen, carve it up, and mix it in the food that was to be prepared for the gods that very evening at their banquet.
A bit of a sociopath, this fellow.
Yes. They'd make a movie about this.
They did. American Psycho was...
I just want to note that, you know, the Greeks were the ones who give us this skill in telling blood-curdling dramas and adventures. I mean, there's so many great stories. And Theseus and the Minotaur, Perseus and Bellerophon... Medusa.
Yeah, all you horror film fans, which I count myself as one, you can point to the Greeks for sort of the roots of all those stories that you enjoy. You
know, I'm sure they appeared in other cultures, but in the Western, you know, in the Western tradition, I think the Greeks really were the first to really do this in a big, such a dramatic way. And I think a lot of adult literature, young adult literature is really a retelling of a lot of these Greek myths. I mean,
well, Percy Jackson is huge. Yeah, Percy Jackson. And you know, I think the full title is Percy Jackson and the Olympians. So he invokes a lot of the Greek gods and they become plot devices. So.
Oh, yeah. And what's the one about the witch, the school for the witches?
Harry Potter and all
that.
Yeah,
Harry Potter. Yeah. You know, there's a lot of references in there to ancient things in Greek. So anyway, now, back to this young king. His hatred must have been out of control, Jeff, you think, for him to sacrifice his son for this very purpose. You know, there must be more to the story that I couldn't track it down. You know, what was his reason? Could you have done it? Not that, you know, all life is important. So,
or was he just you know, completely mad? I mean, yeah, that's the thing. You don't always have to have a reason, you know.
Looking for logic where there is none. Right. Kind of applicable to today's environment. Sure. We're not operating on a plane of logic anymore. We're just being manipulated and lied to and whatever. It's hard to find truth, in other words. So anyway. Absolutely. Now, he sacrificed his son for this purpose and to bring on the gods the horror after the fact that they had been cannibals. There's that taboo word, cannibals. And the Donner Party comes to mind. Remember that in American history in 1848 something? I can't remember. But anyway. But the gods were no fools, Jeff, of course. As the food was brought in on platters and placed on the table, one of the gods, and some say it was Zeus himself, others say that was another, but that's beside the point. This god, whoever it was, alerted the others that something was amiss. Hold it. Stop. And they were all put on their guard. And after looking at the food and after questioning their host, you can only imagine after getting the evil eye and, you know, being interrogated by the gods, he broke down and he confessed. He broke. And Zeus turned on this young king, his son, in outrage. Zeus declared that his son should be punished in such a severe way that never again, Jeff, would any human being ever dare insult them.
Trying to dissuade humans from feeding other humans to them at parties. That's what you're saying.
They're kind of like Old Testament gods you know, really.
Wrathful, vengeful gods, yes.
Yeah, so they put their heads together and discussed it and devised a punishment that was both clever and extreme. And that's what I'm going to get into. It was one of those things, you know, where the punishment fits the crime very carefully yes. and in a very detailed way. And so I'm just thinking about this young king. What caused him to go ahead and do this? You know, was he tempted by the devil? He must have been. And so is it time for a break here yet, Jeff?
How did you know?
Oh, I saw you getting a little yeah, antsy over there, so I led right into that. So let's, if he was being tempted, let's just go with our concept of evil, the devil. So let's listen to the Stones sing one of their classic rock and roll songs, Sympathy for the Devil. Be back in a few minutes.
After we sell some things. took out the Tsar and the ministers, apparently, is this mysterious person they're singing about.
He was a busy guy.
Absolutely. Hey, we should do a programming note while we're here. If you're listening to us on the radio right now, you're probably listening on Wednesday. Wednesday at 7 p.m. We're shuffling the schedule a little bit.
Oh, well.
Playing the devil's advocate here.
My thousands of listeners will please note that change.
Port that over into your phone, absolutely. Perfect. So we're going to give that a try and see if we spike your listenership or reduce it. And then yeah, we'll put you back on Sunday.
We'll see.
You got to move things around. We've been there for a long time.
I mean, so
freshen up the curtains here at the studio.
And Jeff, you want to put in a plug for your new show?
Oh, well, geez, now I'm all sheepish. All right, fine. So if you're listening and it's Sunday night and you're wondering,
you're looking for me,
looking for Jerry, you're
going to
find me.
Absolutely,
not better, just different, just different. It's a show called Front Row Center, and we're going to do it our main movie review, film criticism show, hour long, 7 to 8 p.m. Central. Sunday nights, and I have a co-host that's doing that with me. And for the first week, we're taking in a new one on Netflix and a new one in the theater. We're going to cover the new Eddie Murphy film, Dolomite Is My Name, a little historical piece, actually. You might be interested in that one. Very interesting. I watched it, actually, a few nights ago, and it was very funny. And Eddie Murphy is, for all intents and purposes, back. I mean, he's very wonderful in this thing. I could even see some sort of award for his work in this thing. It was that good. And then we're going to take in this weekend the new Terminator movie, which I'm a little scared about because they keep trying with that franchise and they just can't quite close the deal.
Well, I'm glad to see Eddie Murphy back because he's got so much talent.
Remarkably talented.
Yeah,
he was kind of acting to eat for a while, I think. And no good can come of that, ultimately, except for paychecks, but we suffer.
Well, let's go and see that movie.
It is streaming on Netflix. I believe there are some theatrical options out there, but primarily on Netflix. And it's about a guy named Rudy Ray Moore, an actual stand-up comic and actor from the 70s who was very much an underground success. And filled the theaters with his movie Dolomite, The Human Tornado, and The Avenging Disco Godfather.
That's quite a title.
It is quite the title.
Now, you're saying that Eddie Murphy movie, the Dolomite movie, is on Netflix.
It is only, by and large, only on Netflix. I think a few in the larger metropolitan areas, you can catch it in
Well, I'm going to go home and give that a look.
I think you'll enjoy it immensely.
Well,
it's a lot of fun. A little raw, a little naughty, but, you know, that's good.
Well, nothing like that ever hurt the box office.
Not a bit.
Not
no.
at all.
Quite the opposite.
We're drawn to that. But, back to Sympathy for the Devil and what made this young king devise this plan to embarrass the gods and kill his son and et cetera. So he gets caught and they make up the punishment. Okay. Now, here's what it was.
I'm ready.
Yeah. This young king was forever, and that means for eternity.
Yes.
When you go to hell, you know, it's forever.
It's not a pit stop or a way station or a... no, you're there.
James Joyce described in Portrait of the Artist as a young man. What eternity was, his description, he's sitting when he was in school. He's describing his school days, and the priest is giving the boys a lecture. He says, what eternity in hell is like, please imagine, if you will, being in hell and suffering the worst pain you could ever, the suffering so deep and lasting. And every 1,000 or 10,000 years, a bird comes and takes this. Oh, no, I messed that up.
It's all right.
No, you're sitting on top of a pile of sand that's just 1,000 feet high. It's immense. And every 1,000 years, a little bird comes and takes one grain of sand away.
Wow.
After that whole pile of sand is gone, only one moment of eternity has passed. He was just trying to get them to imagine what was that like to be there forever. So, it's, you know, a little fear.
You better get to the post office and change your mailing address if you're in hell.
That's right.
That's where your mail's coming.
But that's this young king, that's where he was. He was forever placed in a pool of water in the deepest realm of Hades, which is their word for their underworld. Kind of akin to the innermost circle of hell in Dante's Inferno.
Sure.
That was reserved for traitors and the worst of criminals.
I remember when Milk was making a big comeback and they were had a big marketing push, and they had a commercial with a guy who had obviously passed away, and finds this gigantic pile of chocolate chip cookies. And he says, "Oh, I made it. I'm where I want to be." Unfortunately, there was no milk anywhere. So he clearly was in the other place. He's like, wait a minute, where am I?
That's cruel. It's like the guy who, you know, he was in the basement of the library and the nuclear bomb went off.
Sure.
And he was thought, I'm fine, I'm in the library, but then his glasses fell off and he couldn't read anymore. That's
Burgess,
an old Twilight.
Burgess Meredith, old Twilight Zone, absolutely. Yeah. Returning to movie theaters, they're doing the 60th year of the Twilight Zone, and they're putting in movie theaters on the big screen. I think they're putting together like four of the best episodes, according to the gatekeepers,
of course,
and showing them on the big screen. So that's out there. I believe that's happening soon, like this week or next week.
Okay, well, worth a look. Thanks for the tip there, Jeff.
Always.
But here we have to get back to this young king sitting
right.
in the innermost, deepest realm of hell, Hades. But it was here, when he finally got there, that the gods got creative and made the punishment closely fit the crime. And here's what they did, Jeff. While standing up to his knees in a pool of water in this deepest realm of Hades, he was given the most deep and severe thirst that just parched his throat
yes.
and made his entire body yearn for a drink of the water in which he was standing. But whenever he bent down with his hands to scoop up the water and bring it to his lips, the water would begin receding lower and lower, always just out of reach of his fingertips, until it disappeared altogether. And all that his fingertips managed to touch was the dry dirt and dust now beneath his feet.
Cruel bastards, those lot.
Yeah.
Aren't they?
And when he returned to a standing position, the water would slowly rise from the ground, but again, always remain just below his fingertips. And no matter how many times he tried to reach the water, he was so close. But the results were always the same, Jeff. And to that great thirst then was added extreme frustration to his punishment. And in this way, he was made to suffer the torment of his thirst forever. Not just for 10 to 20.
Be like turning me loose this morning and, you know, I've got my coffee pot and my cup and my grounds and I'm all set to go, but there are no filters anywhere.
We are
anywhere in Cedar Bay.
How
can you imagine?
How can you even live?
It's my version of that. We're
such wimps, all of us. No, include myself definitely in that. But Jeff, this was not all.
Oh, good.
It goes on.
Sure.
Yeah. The gods were not done with this guy yet. Now, remember that the gods had been invited to the king's table for a banquet of fine food, but had been tricked. So, while the young king, probably stripped of his title though at this point, while he stood in that water in Hades, he was also given the deepest and most acute sensation of hunger that an individual could possibly feel. Imagine that, Jeff. When are you at your hungriest? Just that stomach needs something.
Absolutely.
You know, that. Yeah. So, just above his head then, above his head, they put the boughs of a fruit tree that dangled its ripe and succulent treats right before his eyes. But when he reached for the fruit in order to pick it and satisfy his ravenous appetite, what do you think happened, Jeff?
I imagine either the branch would, since I see their MO here and what they're doing, the branch would probably yank upwards and be out of reach.
Whenever his hands approached the fruit, a wind arose.
Of course.
And bent the boughs of the tree, so the fruit was always just out of reach of his fingertips. And when his hands were withdrawn, the wind would recede. And again, Jeff, the fruit hung above him within easy reach, but again, so far away. And this went on forever. And no matter how many times he tried to reach out and grab the fruit or food before him to quench that appetite, the results were always the same. And Jeff, there he remains.
Right as we speak.
Until now, you know, that was...
We should have had him on.
And forever.
Today, he was available for interviews. So how's it going out there?
I think we'd have to go there.
I'll only go so far for this show, Jerry.
We've been to hell. Hey, you could take this equipment and let's load it up. We go to Summer Sounds.
I'd rather do a phone interview, actually. Yeah, I'd rather just, you know...
My people will contact his people.
Yes, I'm sure I hope he has an agent.
Now, that's where he remains until now and forever. His throat always parched while standing in a pool of water, and his deep hunger multiplied innumerable times by seeing a feast always swaying before his eyes. Thus was the punishment of the Greek gods of Olympus toward this young king.
So, kids, if you're tempted to thumb the gods in the eye, perhaps rethink it.
There's more to the story, though.
Oh, of course.
We're not over yet. I mean, this is something. In the aftermath of this punishment being set in motion, though, Jeff, the gods restored the king's murdered son, Pelops, back to life. So there is something of a nice ending
I'm
here.
I'm glad they found, when they weren't busy torturing this person.
He just didn't let the injustice stand. After all, this young man had been an innocent victim of his father's deceitfulness. Now, when they gathered up his flesh and bones to reassemble him, they discovered he was missing one of his shoulders.
Aha.
So they fashioned one out of ivory, and this he carried with him for the rest of his life. And the reason for this is that it seems that one of the goddesses did not hear the warning that Zeus uttered about the... adulteration of the food, let's say.
Uh-huh.
And had not heard the warning in time to prevent her from taking a bite of the loathsome meal. So Pelops led a happy and constructive life as king of Lydia. He became the king, performing a lot of good deeds and heroic acts. But he never saw his father again, nor did anyone else, because he's busy down in the deepest realm of Hades. Now, Jeff, this is a story of someone who is punished by having something they so desperately desire placed right in front of them.
Right.
Okay. So close that they can almost taste it and feel it.
Indeed.
It becomes something of a tease. A torment.
Yes.
A torture. Okay.
I feel like I know a little bit about this, but go right ahead.
Now, I haven't told you the name of this ancient Greek king who was the faithless and traitorous son of Zeus, and his name was Tantalus.
Aha.
And it is from his name that we get the word in our English language that means to tempt, to beguile, to lure seductively, kind of to excite.
Indeed.
And to fascinate. Kind of like that candy cake thing. Remember when we were doing Baby Ruth?
I do remember that,
Precursor of the Baby Ruth candy bar was the candy cake thing, and we said, well, that sounds really good.
Yeah, we were a little saddened that it didn't still exist.
Yeah, don't bring back the candy cake.
Absolutely.
But anyway, tempt, beguile, to lure, excite, fascinate. Tantalize.
That's
the word. Tantalize.
The word of the day,
now,
kids.
Here's a detour. This came up for me when I was doing this. The word fascinate.
Yes.
Jeff, has anyone ever called you fascinating, Jeff? Other than all of our listeners, of course. All of your listeners. Here.
I'm striving to be fascinating. Let's put it that way. Has I don't think I've quite you? Achieved it yet, but it's a journey.
Well, this is another one of these things that this is a word that people use. Find that movie fascinating, or this piece of artwork is fascinating.
Mr. Spock would spill that out frequently. That was sort of his understatement word. Like they were surrounded by Klingons, and their phasers were set to kill. And Spock would raise an eyebrow and say, "Fascinating."
Yes.
Which is kind of like
here on History Spaces, we're just fascinating.
Absolutely.
And Jeff will be fascinating on his movie review show. So tune him in.
I hope so.
Now. Fascinating. How about in the sense that you cannot take your eyes off of something?
Yes.
Like fascinating. Absolutely. You're just at like a movie or artwork or a sunset or any beautiful image or what you consider a beautiful person.
Sure. Candy cake.
Yeah, candy cake, a beautiful candy bar. Now, that's a word we use regularly. It's really all over.
Comes up quite a bit.
But we aren't aware of its off-color and pornographic origins. I'm here to burst your bubble.
So glad you stopped by, Jerry.
You'll never want to be called fascinating again after I'm done with you here. Now, we have to go to ancient Rome and the Latin language for this one. They're the ones who spoil this now. A big thing in ancient Rome was tag. We'd call it tagging, tagging on walls and all this.
Sure.
And it was this way that people made known their political views sometimes during a political campaign, as well as just vandalizing walls and buildings and, trying to insult people or neighbors or whatever. But this was quite a common thing. Now, I don't want to offend ears here, but...
Here comes.
Pictures of penises would appear as outrageous comments, insults, or images.
Sure.
On the walls of ancient Rome, in the streets.
It's a reliable, reliable standby.
Yeah. Kind of like street art.
When in doubt.
Now, the Latin word, fascinum, F-A-S-C-I-N-U-M, fascinum, means... erect penis.
Hello.
And from that we get our word fascinating.
Aha.
So when you use that word, think about how it has become divorced from its origins. Because you can't
That's okay.
You can't take your eyes off of something, because you're fascinating. Well, it's really referring to a very specific part of human anatomy.
There's that wonderful scene, and this reminds me of in Monty Python's The Life of Brian, which is a great film. One of the has more to say about the human condition than most serious films, And the People's Front of Judea, which Brian joins because he wants to strike out against the Romans. They send him on a task. They send him with some red paint, and they tell him to paint all over, basically in Latin, of course. Romans, go home. Well, he's doing it. He's painting away, a modest version of that. And Centurion grabs him from behind, John Cleese, actually, and says, "What are you doing?" He says, "I'm saying, I'm painting, And he says, "What does that say?" He says, "Romans, go home." He says, "Really?" He says, "You didn't conjugate the verb here." He says, "Romani, however." So he says, "I want you to do it 5,000 times on this wall the right way, And you can't leave until you can. If you don't, I'll, slay you or whatever." So, Brian paints it all over the wall. And then, it takes him all night. And the entire wall is just coated with "Romans, go home." with the proper conjugation.
Of course.
And then two Roman centurions walk up and see what he's doing. And they chase him because they're going to kill him because of what he wrote all over the wall. So, it's a wonderful movie.
I know. I have to go there. Isn't in this one of the big... people used to complain about Winnie the Pooh because he'd misspell words or, those books.
Oh, right. Of course.
All that. We dealt with that in an episode. But then, English teachers, too, object to, our president when he tweets because he's not careful enough about his spelling or his usage or his grammar.
Oh, not a bit.
Let alone truthfulness. But, it's so...
Trumpese, we call it.
Yeah, maybe that's just the downgrading of our language, though, over time because of media. And people just spit things out without talking. And I know even if I do an email or a WhatsApp, a message, I always am very careful about speaking in complete sentences and making sense and being clear.
So. You're one of the few. You know, you're kind of fighting a losing battle over there.
I'm sorry. I read Jane Austen. I read Edith Wharton. And I can't.
Both of which have been amazing tweeters and Facebook users, I'm sure.
Oh, those, they wouldn't be limited by 144 words or whatever that limitation
find that
is.
Very distasteful, I'm sure.
You know, those 19th century English novels were quite long. But anyway, back to this word fascinating and the pornographic images on the walls of Roman streets, etc. So maybe I've spoiled the use of it in your vocabulary entirely.
Well, we hope so. If we didn't do
next time someone says you're fascinating or you use the word, think about this. Now, to wrap up here, I just want to. So we've mentioned three words that express kind of a progression. First, there's fascination.
Indeed.
Can't take your eyes off something. You're kind of drawn to it. Okay. And then there's tantalization.
Yes.
Tantalus, the story we've just told. And you're tantalized, you know, just kind of, you're lured. And okay. And then there's outright full-blown temptation.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, like what you feel, Jeff, when you go walking past Boulangerie du Monde here in Cedarburg?
Oh, certainly.
Or how about Amy's?
Absolutely.
Or maybe the Chocolate Factory. Oh, some ice cream.
The roastery pulls me in.
Oh, yes. And they're homemade things. Go try it. There you have four examples of tantalization.
Yes.
Boulangerie, Amy's, Chocolate Factory, and the roastery.
Straight up temptation.
There we go. And in honor of the word fascination, let's end with a song. And it's a nice low tempo, easy tempo song by Nat King Cole. He did it in the 50s. It was called It Was Fascination. Jeff, we'll see you next week.
Next week it is. Remember, everybody, Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. is the new place to find History Spaces with our host. Thank you.
Okay. See you, everyone.
And it might have ended right then at the start. Just a passing glance, just a brief romance, and I might have gone on my way empty-hearted. It was fascination, I know, seeing you alone with the moon light above. Then I touch your hand, and next moment I kiss you. Fascination turned to